Welcome everyone to this webinar hosted by Toradex entitled EtherCAT Master Software from Setup to Application Implementation in No Time. We have with us today our guest and partner, Acontis Technologies. My name is André Curvelo and I am a FAE and Technical Evangelist at Toradex. Let me introduce you to the guests and presenters of the day. Here we have Christoph Wiedmann, which is Managing Director and Product Manager for EtherCAT at Acontis Technologies. And we also have Holger Oilhef, who is a software developer and EtherCAT Master Team at Acontis Technologies as well. Before we dive into the webinar, let me cover a few organizational points. Please use the chat window of the webinar tool if you have any technical issues and wish to let us know. At the end, we will also do an interactive question and answer section, so you can type your questions in the chat window anytime and we'll pick them up at the end. The webinar will be recorded and made available for on-demand viewing later, so you can watch this later anytime you want. With this, let's get started. I will begin with a very brief overview who Toradex is and what we do. Toradex is focusing on making embedded computing easy to use, so you can get simple access to the latest technology for your product development. We are doing so by providing highly reliable ARM system and module, including software and support. We are striving to offer the lowest cost of ownership to you. And this doesn't just mean the module price, but also consideration of aspects like your development effort, time to market, and long-term maintenance. We are proud of being able to have industry-leading support, including a very active community and a developer page with over 800 articles, which is updated daily. As you can see, we have offices around the world with local support and warehouses. Me, for example, I'm talking right now from São Paulo, Brazil. Here is a short overview of our products. We have three SOM families. Inside these families, the modules are pin compatible, so you can seamlessly scale from i.MX 6 over i.MX 7 to the i.MX 8. We are also providing production quality software with these modules, but you'll learn more about our products later. I'd like also to explain our focus applications as we are optimizing our products and offerings for them. Here, to mention, I can say that we're working on industrial automation, healthcare, transportation, test and measurement, and smart city. Typical projects are customers with volume requirements of a few hundreds to a few tens of thousands products per year. Toradex itself has thousands of active customers. Apart from the highly reliable system and modules, Toradex also provides production-ready software, including reference images for the Yoke project. Toradex is also active in mainlining code for system on modules. And here, I'd like to present you our Torizon, which is a brand new free offering from Toradex. It's open source and easy to use industrial Linux platform. It focuses on lowering your time to market and can be used out of the box. It's based on open software, so you have no lock-in and you can adjust it to your needs. Toradex comes with an automotive grade update client, so to allow for simple, safe, and secure software updates. As an example, software updates with this update client are safe even if you lose power in the worst possible moment. Security is another focus here. Frequent updates and simple access to the hardware security features that make it easy for you to develop a secure device. Also, a real-time virtualization is also available as an option. Modern continuous integration and verification processes make sure every Toradex release is stable And Horizon is built with the Yocta project and utilizes Docker for software containerization, tapping into a fast software ecosystem. Now, let me just give you a brief warm-up of what a contest will present in a few moments. A contest has an excellent expertise in adapting Ethernet drivers for usage within embedded Linux systems for EtherCAT Master Profile. And today, they are going to show how you can use and program on of Toradex computer modules to work in that way. Thanks for joining us today, Acontis. Now you have the word.
Hello, everybody. My name is Christoph Wittmann, and I'd like to give you a brief overview about Acontis and our EtherCAT solutions. Acontis was founded almost 20 years ago by Stefan and myself as independent software vendor. Today, 70 people are working in our office in Ravensburg, and last year our revenue was about 4.2 million euro. The company is independent and privately owned. Our products are used worldwide. Therefore, Acontis is also selling its software products with the support of our local partners to customers in America, Europe, and Asia. Acontis is offering software products for real-time Ethernet communication, mainly EtherCAT and TSN, and also to run a real-time operating system alongside with Windows. This is supplemented by professional services. All right, now we want to run a quick poll about the field bus you are using already today, or maybe even not. All right, so, and we leave that a little open for a few seconds. And interesting. Oh, yeah, you are already working with EtherCAT, and I see that a lot of you have experience with CAN and CAN open. Yeah, and that's also, let's say, what we learned in the past, that people are moving from CAN or CAN open to EtherCAT. Thank you for that valuable input. All right, let's continue. We are providing EtherCAT software products for automation controllers like PLCs, motion controllers, and so on. Our software is also used for applications using the EtherCAT communication just internally, like industrial and surgical robots, like test benches, semiconductor tools, and so on. Also, companies creating slave devices are making use of our tools for testing them in the lab and the production. A typical process to create an EtherCAT application starts with the integration of the EtherCAT Master software. In the next step, supported by our tool, Easy Engineer, the network topology is planned and the slave devices are configured. Virtual commissioning becomes more and more important to reduce the time to market. Our tool, Easy Simulator, is a network simulation software able to simulate the whole network communication in real time. During commissioning, the diagnosis features of Easy Engineer are a great support. The Easy Lizer tool helps the maintenance staff to provide slave firmware updates and to diagnose problems. I think now is a good time to ask you, what do you want to implement? So, are you looking for implementing an EtherCAT master controller, an EtherCAT slave device, maybe a master controller and a slave device, or currently you have no plans to implement EtherCAT at all? So we keep that also open for a few seconds, and then I will talk a little bit about the result. Okay, yeah, interesting. So. Good, yeah, we are talking about EtherCAT Master, so you are mainly looking for master controller, but also I see that a broad audience, many people have to implement slave and master devices. Yeah, very interesting. Thank you. Okay. A typical system architecture looks like this. On the master hardware, we have a standard Linux, optionally with real-time performance. The EtherCAT Master Library provides a C API to the application. To create the required network configuration, we will use the tool Easy Engineer. Every slave comes with an EtherCAT slave information file, the so-called ESI file. The file describes all features and options of the slave. Based on the ESI, the operator creates the EtherCAT network information, the ENI file. This is required by the master. The optional TCP/IP connection enables the Rust client and server to provide online services like scanning the network in Easy Engineer. Let's take a more detailed look at the architecture on Linux. The Acontis real-time driver replaces the standard Linux Ethernet driver for EtherCAT usage. The driver runs in user space and handles the MAC directly for the high-performance cyclic operation. The kernel module ATEMSYS grants the access to the hardware by completely bypassing the Linux network stack. This is very important to achieve fast cycle times together with a low CPU load. That's always an interesting question. What cycle time is required for your application? What cycle time do you have to run? Which update rate you need on the slaves? And people with EtherCAT, they are looking for much faster update rates compared to other field bus technologies. So mainly the people are looking for a millisecond or even below, but also there are applications which do not require this very high update rate. So you see in this poll, we have several ranges, 4 kilohertz, 1 kilohertz, 250 hertz, or if it's lower than 4 milliseconds, it would be interesting for us to get your response for that. All right. Oh, interesting. Yeah. Okay. The biggest share, it's close to 50%. They need a millisecond. So this is more or less really the standard what people are looking for. But also about a third of you is looking for 250 microseconds. So this sounds like that you need our special architecture that we run a high performance real-time Ethernet driver. And I think 250, so we are mainly looking for connecting drives and doing motion control. Let's continue. So the EtherCAT configuration and diagnosis tool Easy Engineer is available on Engineering on Windows, but also on Linux today. On Linux, Easy Engineer is operated using a standard browser. So it's a very flexible client server architecture, supports to run the front end and the back end on the same machine, but also on different ones. The most common way to create a configuration is to select the slaves based on their name and type from the catalog. By connecting them, the topology is defined. It's also possible to connect the EtherCAT network to the engineering computer and to scan the slaves. Based on the detected vendor ID and product code, the corresponding slaves are added to the configuration. If there is a TCP/IP connection between the engineering computer and the target system, the slaves can also be scanned. For using the Easy Engineer diagnosis features, such a TCP/IP connection is also required. Configuring all types of available EtherCAT slaves is quite challenging. Easy Engineer addresses this task with a very intuitive user interface. You have to try it by yourself. For commissioning powerful online functions like monitoring and forcing, the inputs and outputs are available. Also important, figuring out problems like a swapped in and out port or any kind of other cabling errors or other issues. Okay, so before we jump into the live demo, I want to ask you a last question. Are you already aware of TSN, the time sensitive networking? Have you ever heard about that? Are you considering it for your applications? Yeah, it's TSN is a huge topic in the past years, and I just want to know. Okay, so up to now, let's say, you are not really, most people are not aware of it. Some of you have already heard about that, but most of you are not really considering it now. So it's maybe a future topic. But some of you have already started with the development of products. So interesting. All right, so now I'd like to hand over to Holger for his presentation, and you will learn about how to use our tools and software.
Hi, my name is Holger Oelhaf. I'm a software developer in the Easy Master team at Acontis. I would like to present you how to get started with Easy Master on the Apelles i.MX 8. Here we have a Toradex Apelles i.MX 8 module on an Xora carrier board with an additional USB to Ethernet device for TCP/IP connection. Also, the host is connected by serial interface. The Ethernet port of the Xora board is connected to two backup EtherCAT couplers with several I/O terminals. One input terminal is equipped for the switch for the later demo. To easily start with the Apelles i.MX 8 and EtherCAT, we created a minimal Linux image containing all necessary binaries and kernel modules. The GCC compiler and GDB debugger is also included. You can install it with the Toradex Easy Installer. To start development, Acontis offers free evaluation versions of our EtherCAT tools. You can register on acontis.com. In this webinar, I use Easy Master for Linux and Easy Engineer. I already have installed Easy Engineer, the Acontis Linux image with Toradex Easy Installer, and unpacked Easy Master Eval package. The TCP/IP connection to the board is already prepared. As you can see, I use WinSCP for file transfers and PuTTY as a console. The username is root without a password. The eval package comes with pre-compiled example application Easy Master Demo in the bin folder, Easy Master Library in the SDK, optimized link layer in the bin folders, example source code, and a workspace for Eclipse IDE. On the right hand side, this is the board content. It comes with a pre-compiled example application, Easy Master Demo, and a link layer and two scripts. The link layer is based on the Linux raw sockets and not real-time capable. A real-time capable optimized link layer is included in the Easy Master Eval package. You can find it on a bin, Linux, RR64, libEML, FasselFag. This name stands for EtherCAT Master Link Layer Freescale Fast Internet Controller. As mentioned from Christoph before, the Easy Master uses the Atomsys kernel module to get direct hardware access. As an initial step, we need to unbind the Ethernet controller from Linux and bind it to our kernel module. This is done by the script bindfec to Atomsys. With dmessage, we can check if the bind was successful. Here we see Atomsys is loaded and the Ethernet device is attached to it. Now let's do a short test to check if Easy Master Demo is running. In the Run Easy Master Demo script, there are several command lines. One for the non-real-time link layer SOC raw, and some more. I use the last one for our real-time optimized link layer. Let me go to the command line first. This is the link layer FASTFAC with its instance in polling mode, and then we have some additional parameters special for the i.MX8. It's connected to RGMI. This is the PHY, a PHY address 7. We use no pin muxing and no MAC address. Since we have no ENI pass to Easy Master Demo, the maximum master state is pre-operational. To create an ENI, I use Easy Engineer to scan the bus remotely via Easy Master Demo. Therefore, I will start the demo again with an additional command line parameter minus SP. This will start the Rust server. In the log, we can see start remote API server now. In Easy Engineer, I have to click on remote configuration, select the master unit class A, type in the IP address and port, click on select, and Easy Engineer is automatically connecting to the port and scanning. In topology view, we can see almost the same as in our board setup. Then we can export the ENI on a local drive, copy it to the board, and run the demo again with the ENI. Therefore, I use an additional parameter minus F. ENI.xml. Okay, now we can see the master state changed from safe up to op. So we are in operational now. So from this point, everything is prepared and works as expected. Now I want to create a small Hello World application based on Easy Master Demo. In the eval package, an Eclipse project is included, which I will use. The example consists of several source files. I will mainly focus on Easy Demo App CPP. And I only need to work on the My App functions. The other code can stay as it is. I will work on my app prepare and my app work PD. So my app prepare is to finding slave parameters. There's already code in there, which I don't need, so I delete it. Almost I delete it. And my app work PD is called every cycle, and in this function we can process on the data from the bus. Okay. The idea of the demo is to count the keystrokes of the switch, which is connected to slave 1004 on the first input, and output the counter value on slave 2003, a 4 output terminal. Every of the I/O terminals got its LED output, so we can see if the counter is working or not. In Easy Engineer, I can get more information about the slaves. For example, the input slave we will use is a Beckhoff EL1014 for channel digital input. Especially, I'm interested in the variables. So you can see we have 4 inputs. The variable name is generated automatically by Easy Engineer from the slave name, the PDO name, and the PDO subentry. Also, we can see the input is mapped to offset 1 in the process data image. Let's go to the code and implement the input. For this, I will use the function EtherCAT find input var by name. This function takes 2 arguments, the variable name and a pointer to a struct called ECT process var info. For this, I create a static variable and pass it to the function. The ECT process var infrastructure contains all necessary information about the process variable, the name, the data type, on which fixed address it's connected to, the bit size, the bit offset, and if it's an input or output. With an additional error print, the preparation for the input is done. Let's go to the outputs again in Easy Engineer. I use slave 1003. The outputs are mapped to offset 2 in the process image with a total size of 4 bits. To get this data in the code, I use another API. It's called EtherCAT get config slave info. It takes 3 arguments. One, which type of addressing we are using. This is true because I want to use the station address. And the station address, 1003. And a pointer to a type of ECT config slave info. Okay, I pass it to the function. The EtherCAT config slave info has many, many informations about the slave, like vendor code, product code, revision number, and also we have the process data offsets for the in and output data. In my example, I will use only need to use the DD offset out. And the PD offset out size. Again, I will store them in two static variables. Another error print. And the configuration of the input and output is already done. So now I can move to the function myWorkPD and implement the counter. First, I need the process data image pointers. We have one PD input pointer and one PD output pointer. You can get it with EtherCAT get process image input or output pointer function. Also, I need two variables for input, one the last and the current input. To read the current input, I use a macro called easy test bit. This macro takes two parameters, a pointer to the buffer, in this case PD input, and the bit offset. The bit offset in the input from the input variable is stored in my static variable and bit offset. So that's it. Now we have read the current state of the switch from the process data image. And I need two ifs because I only want to count on the key release. And then I can implement the counter. I use a local variable. I only use an 8-bit counter. Read the current value from the process data image, from the process data output image, with the macro easy copy bits. This macro takes 5 arguments, a pointer to the destination with the bit offset, in this case our local variable, then the source, which is the PD output, the process image output pointer, the offset. This is the offset of our slave 2003 and the size, which is 4. Then we can count up and update the outputs again with the easy copy bits macro. This time we swapped destination and source pointers. As a last step, I update my last input value. Okay, save it and build the binaries. Okay, building was successful. Now I can copy it to the board and check out the application. The binary is located in folder bin linux rr64 debug. I overrided the existing demo on the board and started again. Okay, the master is in operational now. So now I will start counting. as you can see, it count 3 times here. Okay, if I want to move my counter values to another I/O terminal, for example, this slave here, 1002, I only have to change the fixed address, the address of the slave in EtherCAT get config slave info. Save it and build it again. Copy it to the board. And restart the application. Now, if I press the switch, the counter value is not a slave. The Easy Engineer has also built in diagnostics features. With clicking on the button Diagnosis Mode, it automatically connects to the board and scans the bus again. Here we can see that all slaves are marked as green, which means they're in operational state. With a click on slave 1002, we can monitor the state of the outputs. I can click again, and it's counting up. Also, I can monitor the inputs and we can force the input. This means I can virtually click the switch by Easy Engineer. Now it's counted up. To make this more convenient, it's possible to create a watch list. Let's add the input to the watch list and some of the outputs. Okay, with clicking on Easy Master watch list, we see the inputs and the outputs. And now I will force the input again, and we see it's counting up. Also, I can force the outputs. Let me start the demo again. It's only running 2 minutes. With the minus T parameter 0, it runs almost an hour. Restart, reconnect, okay. So, add it to the watch list again. So now I can force this output as false, and when I'm counting up, it will not increase. So counting again, we see the second output will go up or not. Okay, that's it from my side.
Thank you very much, Holger. And I hope you enjoyed this presentation as much as I did. I always love to see some live coding. That's awesome. And just to let you know, we already have a demo image for the Apple's i.MX 8 QuadMax, the Toradex computer module that was used in this demonstration. That is already available through our Toradex Easy Installer, as you can see here on the screen. If you have a module similar to that, similarly, you see a message like this on your Toradex Easy Installer. In addition to that, a step-by-step guide for it is also available at our developer portal. And I just want to emphasize that going forward into the demonstration example will require contact with the contest for access to the additional modules. So here, just to mention, as you can see, we already have live in here a contest technologies page in our developer portal talking about our partnership, what about contest technologies, and about the pre-built images we already have. And here you can see the step-by-step page for the demo image. Here we have some considerations, kind of a little bit similar to what you saw here in the webinar, but the webinar live coding, that's incomparable. And then in the end, of course, please, if you enjoy that and want to exercise this for real, then go and get in contact with the contest, and they'll give you the best attention as possible. And then you'll be also requiring your evaluation request for them. So good point in here. Holger and Christoph, do you want to mention anything about this evaluation request or how to conduct the partner demo image? Or I think that's all for the moment.
I think that's all for the moment, just one thing. So the evaluation version is free of charge, and the restriction is that the master is just running 1 hour, and afterwards you have to restart it. But for doing the first steps, I think 1 hour is okay.
Mm-hmm. Oh, excellent. Thank you. Now I'll be opening the session for questions and answers. So please, if you have anything, feel free to write in the chat. We'll be discussing in here, me, Christoph, and Holger, the best way to answer your questions and doubts about EtherCAT and Toradex modules. So here I have one. Let me see. Someone is asking, what is the fastest cycle time I can achieve with EtherCAT and your master software? What do you say about that, Holger or Christoph?
Yeah, I think this is, let me try to answer that. This is a quite difficult question to answer, but because it depends on many parameters. So it depends on, for sure, on the size of the network, so the number of slaves, but also it depends on the payload you want to exchange. So the number of inputs and output data bytes you want to exchange between the slaves. And also, let's say it depends for sure from the board you are using to run the EtherCAT software. But it's also, let's say, very important always to consider, okay, how much time I want to spend on the communication part. So how much time I want to spend with the EtherCAT master, but also how much time I need for my application. So there are many, many parameters also if you are using distributed clocks or not and so on. So to get the rough estimation about the cycle time and also, let's say, the CPU load caused by the stack, we have created a web page. We call it EtherCAT cycle time calculator, where you can, let's say, have several parameters you can input. And on this page, we doing, let's say, calculating how much time you need for the communication part, the round trip time. And based on that values, you can say, okay, maybe my communication time is, in this example, 170 microseconds. So maybe I'm good to run with a cycle time down to 250, but not faster. So this is some help to get, let's say, a first rough idea about that. But also I want to mention that we have an integrated performance measurement in our example applications. So you can get the real numbers, the real load by simply starting our example application on a specific board with a specific setup, and then you will get these numbers, and then you know, okay, on this board with this setup, the master requires 100 microseconds.
Excellent. Thanks for the details, Christoph. And we have here also another question. There is, are redundant topologies supported by EtherCAT and your master software?
Let me answer this. Yes, we fully support cable redundancy. This means if you have two Ethernet ports on our host, for example, the Apelles, this is supported by EasyMaster. We call it cable redundancy. Also, we support junction redundancy. If you have an EtherCAT junction device to build topology rings, this is supported by EasyMaster. All with DC distributed clock support. And also we have the master redundancy option for highly available system. This means we have two independent masters in the system.
Nice, good. And here also another question, also related to you. Does your master software work with every EtherCAT slave?
Yes. So EasyMaster works with every slave that has passed the Ethernet conformance test. To ensure this high interoperability, we participate in every PlugFest event from the EtherCAT technology group in Europe and worldwide. So the PlugFests are every 6 months, and we are participating always.
Excellent.
And yeah, let me add one thing. So I just want to mention that there are about 1,000 different slave device manufacturers already worldwide. So 1,000 companies have already developed an EtherCAT slave device. I do not really know the real number, but it's interesting that already 3,000 companies worldwide has asked the EtherCAT technology group for a vendor ID. And the vendor ID typically you require if you want to develop an EtherCAT slave device. So my estimation is that already 1,000 or even more different manufacturers of EtherCAT slave devices are around in the world. So I think this is a very amazing number.
Mm-hmm. I agree. So it's a topic that's calling more and more attention.
Yeah.
Excellent. And here, going to another question. Now I think we are going down to some other technical details. I think I can answer that, but I need confirmation from you, Christoph and Holger. Is it possible to build an EtherCAT master directly from Toradex DSP, or is it required to get the binaries from a CompTIS? So I think that based on the ATEMSYS driver, we are adding to our BSP the latest one, as we discussed it before, for the i.MX 8. In regarding the ATEMSYS driver for direct access to the Ethernet module, that is something that we can directly build to the with the Toradex BSP. But is there anything else required? What do you say?
It's only the master package required. So the Toradex BSP comes with the Yocto receive for the ATEMSYS kernel module.
Mm-hmm.
And then you only need our SDK to start software developing.
Nice. So the driver, he can pack directly through the BSP, Then go to the evaluation, having the resources from your SDK.
Yes.
Excellent. Good.
Depending on the board, you got the link layer, in this case for the Freescale. Mm-hmm. This is all included in the SDK.
Nice. Excellent. Thank you. And here also other interesting questions that possibly I'm going to ask you guys to answer those. So here, for example, a nice one from Zigbinu W. Does the master occupy single core? So yes, his concern is like I have a quad core or octa core SOC here. Then I can lock this.
You know, for sure, you can, let's say, specify that the master is running just on one specific core. So you will set the affinity for these threads that they just run on a specific core. But you do not need a complete core just for the EtherCAT master. That's hopefully mm-hmm. not. So typically it's maybe just 10 or maybe up to 20% of the performance of a whole core is required by the master. So typical applications, it's just 5% of a core you need for the communication and 95% is for the application. So you do not have to spend the whole core for communication. That would be a very bad implementation of an EtherCAT master.
Mm-hmm. Nice. So this emphasizes that your kernel driver is very lightweight and very optimized. Good.
Yeah.
Here also the other question: do you offer Linux distributions? No, this is us. Linux distributions capable for running ROS, which is the robot operating system. Rafael Zimmerman, actually, for you to adapt a robotic operating system, that is capable for you to do within Yocto. So our Linux distribution, they are perfectly built upon Yocto. So it's just a matter of you to using the correct and compatible recipes for you to have all the packages for a ROS or ROS2 environment to use. So good one, thank for that. And here, same question, occupies reserve single core in order to keep real time. No, I think that it also comes back to the answer you were talking about a few moments ago, Chris, that even with a single core, you can keep the real time with your driver, right?
Sure. Yeah, so the it's I think that the driver is the main, let's say, difference between, let's say, other solutions and our solution, that we have our own driver, everything is in user space, but we have the full performance for accessing the hardware even in user space. And the goal is always that, let's say, the communication part is not more than 10% of the load of a core, so that let's say the biggest portion is for application. And let me maybe just add some comment to the question regarding the ROS operating system. ROS is let's say already an application layer, so that means that is on top of the EtherCAT master, and for sure you can connect the ROS, which is the robot operating system, but it's more or less an infrastructure for doing robotics. You can connect this ROS software to our EtherCAT master.
Nice. Oh, excellent. Very good to know that. Good addition. And here from Marcin Paprikis. So here, do you support CA4? I will copy and paste that in the chat for you, Christopher. See here.
I think CIA 402 or DSP 402. I think it's the device profile 402. Yes, that's a profile for drives. And so, what is meaning a profile? A profile is more or less a well-defined set of objects and PDOs, But this is, let's say, not really related to the EtherCAT Master itself. It's already on top that you have to, let's say, make use of this well-defined objects. We are providing a motion control example application. It's free of charge. It's a motion control example. And with this application, we are dealing with drives which are built according to the 402 profile. So it makes an easy start for you. And also we have a support in our tool Easy Engineer for configuring this motion control example application.
Nice. Here from Gopi, how to set other slave network topologies like star?
Ah, okay. Yeah, that's quite simple. So you manually can choose if you add a device to which port you want to add that new device. For sure, you have to have, let's say, a device which is free port or with many free ports. So they are so-called junction devices. A junction device may offer up to 8 ports. So you have 1 in port and 7 out ports. And then you can select, okay, I want to add that slave to that port and so on. So it's more or less up to you how to connect your the cables, and then you can build the star topology or any other topology.
Excellent. Here, Michael Egli, I learned that there is a class A and class B master stack. What is the difference? Could you explain the difference of them?
Yeah, so the class B is the, let's say, the basic master already offering many, let's say, standard stuff for sure, cyclic data, also the most common mailbox protocol, the COE. So this is, let's say, for basic applications for doing IOs. If you want to operate drives or other, let's say, devices which are requiring the precise synchronization based on the distributed clocks technology, you have to go with the class A master. So the class A is mainly for supporting this precise synchronization thing, the DC, and also brings some additional support for, let's say, special mailbox protocols, which is not, let's say, like several drive over EtherCAT, file over EtherCAT and so on. So, but the main difference is the DC distributed clocks. If you need DC or not, yeah, it's up to your application. Typically, if you have drives and motion control, DC is required, but also not in all cases.
Mm-hmm. Interesting. Thank you. And here is a very long question. I will be saying that, and please also be reading and sending that in the chat for us. Here is, on 1 millisecond cycle time, how many bytes could I transmit in DC mode over the PDIOs with your master? I'm developing a slave with 2000 bytes per millisecond. Could your master handle this amount of data?
Yeah, that's let's say already something I already tried to answer in the first question. I say, okay, on such a CPU like an i.MX 8, no problem, no problem. A millisecond, I think within a millisecond, you may be able to handle in total close to 10 KB of data. So that means everything is more or less using the DMA transfer, so you can exchange 10,000 bytes per millisecond on such a i.MX 8 CPU, no problem. The question is always, okay, is your application and the code behind able to handle this huge amount of data with a millisecond? So if you are looking for a motion control or a PLC application, you will get 10,000 bytes per millisecond, and you need a software to work on that. So mainly the bottleneck is always the application and not the communication. From the communication part, I say no problem, you can do that, but is the overall system performance enough to do the application? That's another question.
Yes, good point. Good point. And here, I think that to be a joint question, the joint answer for this question, Urs Jagi is making this question, which is, which NIC is recommended for the i.MX and EtherCAT? So I would say that any IC that has a reliable time sensitive network stack support, what do you say about that?
No, we don't need that. All the TSN features are not required for EtherCAT. So you can use, let's say, every i.MX controller, i.MX 6, 7, 8, let's say, offered by Toradex. So we support all i.MX 6, 7, and 8.
Nice.
So, yeah.
Oh, excellent.
Also, so we support PCI NICs. So if you want to use the NIC built-in on the Apelles for TCP/IP, you can connect another NIC via PCI. We also have link layers for PCI.
Yes, you can. Yeah, you can plug in an additional Ethernet controller board connected to the PCI Express interface, so that you can add an Intel Realtek or any other controller to this PCI Express lanes.
And also that goes into the direction of another question we have here about the considerations case of the design of a custom carrier board. So could be the possibility to have this through a dedicated Ethernet, through an Ethernet adapter on the PCI Express lanes. And also the Apple i.MX 8, for example, it counts on a secondary Ethernet port as well. So that could be also another possibility. What do you think?
Yes. So typically you need two Ethernet controllers. So the controller on the module you may use for EtherCAT or for TCP/IP, and then you may connect another one using PCI Express lanes. You will plug in a commercial board, or you connect something, mainly Intel and Realtek controllers, and then you can run the EtherCAT communication through that controller, or TCP/IP. So we are very flexible. So we have customers using both solutions. What is not working, do not run EtherCAT through an USB to Ethernet adapter. So because that's slow, no real time. So if you do not want to add an additional controller, or you you run out of interfaces and you are looking for a USB to Ethernet solution, you have to use that for TCP/IP and not for EtherCAT. That's
nice.
Maybe an important point.
Mm-hmm. And then that I think that is interesting, your flow of discussion here, Christoph, because the other question here is like one, it is called, is Ethernet over EtherCAT supported?
Yes, it's supported for sure. We support that. You can tunnel Ethernet traffic through EtherCAT. This is a quite complicated topic, and we have you want to talk from a source to a destination, and the question is if you want to run a communication between an application, which is on the i.MX 8 or in the controller, down to a slave, or if you, it's more or less the question, who wants to communicate with which device and so on. So it's more or less for diagnostic, for doing parameters and so on. It's not recommended to use such a solution for doing the whole TCP/IP communication through such a connection, because the bandwidth is low, and also it's an expensive solution, because if you want to connect a standard TCP/IP network to that Ethernet or EtherCAT, the EOE, you need a so-called switch port device where you, let's say, split the traffic, that you say, okay, you can communicate with Ethernet or TCP/IP to the switch port, and from there you have the EOE. So therefore, you will find some additional slides and information about EOE on our website, but also we have, let's say, some specific slides we can share with you.
Nice. Thank you, Christoph. Here, going to the, I thank you guys. I see that you pass it through our 1 hour here section for webinar, but I see that you guys did a lot of questions, and I'm seeing that we have still a very good amount of people still listening to this question and answer section. I'm very pleased to see the attention and the focus you guys are spending on this, and appreciate that a lot. If you don't mind, Christoph and Holger, we can answer here the few, I think we have 3-5 questions, if you don't mind.
Then, no problem.
No problem. So let's go for it, because I see that we have literally here 52 people still listening. So very good, very nice. So let's see that. Well, here, another question from Gopi, Gopi Krishna. Will EtherCAT support multi-master for redundancy?
I think Holger already answered that a little bit. Multi-master, on one network, typically you can just have one master. So, but we also support a solution where you have, let's say, a backup system which is in the loop and listening the traffic, and which can, let's say, take over control if the main system breaks down. So there is a solution for master redundancy, and yes, you can spend that, but that's an expensive solution. It's also from the hardware point of view, because you need another system with at least two network controllers, because the master redundancy also always requires cable redundancy. Mm-hmm. But we provide that, and also you find more information about that on our website in the master section about the topology and so on.
Excellent. Here a question from Hong Cheng that I think it's almost similar to one I received in the beginning of the webinar. He's also asking here, does the master stack can run on the CPU without an operating system, without an OS?
Yes, it's possible. So we do not need an operating system. We need a runtime environment. We need a C++ compiler and at least, let's say, a C library. So it's possible. So we, beside Linux, we support many other kind of operating systems or kernels, or like FreeRTOS or TiRTOS, or such. Let's say it's not an operating system; it's more or less a runtime environment. Also, we are offering a porting package, so that you are able to port the stack on, let's say, a specific environment. So an operating system is not required. We can run, let's say, on every computer processor, let's say, where you have a C++ compiler. But also I want to add that it's EtherCAT is not working on 16-bit controllers. I don't know if they are around. And also you need some memory for code and for the data. So EtherCAT is not running on, let's say, very small microcontrollers with just internal RAM with, let's say, 256 KB memory and so on. So those very small controllers, they are too small, but the operating system is not required.
Nice. Okay, good to know. And here I think is going also to that discussion of the cycle time. Just to recall this, I think we kind of directly or indirectly response that, but I think it's a compliment. How much is most cycle time possible with your EtherCAT Master, and how many slaves can be addressed with that cycle time?
That's again, I think that on such an i.MX 8, which is has already a good performance, the first thing is that you need a real time Linux, so that you have, let's say, a stable cycle time of 100 microseconds, so that you don't have a huge jitter caused by the operating system. So if you have, let's say, a real-time patch, you have a stable cycle time with low jitter, then you be able, let's say, go down to 100 microseconds. So maybe, I think, not much below. So on an ARM system, we did tests internally on x86 systems, on PCs, Core i7 and so on. So you can go down to 50 microseconds. But let's say on this system, on an i.MX 8, I think 100 microseconds is a cycle time you can go with. Then the question is, okay, how many slaves you can connect? I think maybe 10 slaves is not a problem. And I think you can exchange at least 20 bytes per slave. So I think as a rough estimation, 10 slaves, 200 bytes in and outputs, and 100 microseconds. I think this is, but you really have to measure that by your own. So, and I think this is, let's say, the smallest cycle time and the number of slaves.
Nice. Thank you, Christoph. And here, going to the remaining questions, here from Gopi. I am trying to run slaves connected in EtherCAT topology with EtherCAT Master, and Master was unable to find the slaves connected in EtherCAT topology. My question is, will any masters can have capability to detect any network topology automatically?
Yeah, sure. We can it. We can detect it, and also we will validate it. So for sure, we know the topology, we can detect it, and we if you boot up the master and you provide the configuration, we always validate the configuration with the real network. So, and then you get that if it's not, let's say, connected, if there is something missing, wrong connection, we will notify the application. Also, we can show that in our tool. For sure, we can detect the topology, and we will check the topology, and we will notify the application what is wrong.
Nice. And here, the last one here is also from Gopi. I'm using Toradex Apalis MX6 for his EtherCAT slave, and do you need to get the vendor ID and slave ID from ETG?
Yes, so vendor ID you have to ask the EtherCAT technology group, so it's also free of charge for ETG members. So please go on EtherCAT.org website, there you have to apply for a membership. If not, after you are a member, you can apply for a vendor ID. So this is a unique ID. And then, but the slave ID, I think he is mentioning the product code. And the product code is a 32-bit number, and you can define that by yourself. So if after having your vendor ID, which is also a 32-bit, you can start with defining the product codes, and that's, let's say, up to you.
Nice. Thank you, Christoph and Holger. I think that was all. That was a lot of questions. I'm very glad to see this kind of attention and interested on the EtherCAT topic. And in behalf of Toradex, I want to thank you for making this webinar. It is very good topic, very good presentation. I enjoyed it a lot. Thank you, Christopher. Thank you, Holger. And thank you, everyone that is still watching until now and see after that recording. I would like to invite you to visit our Toradex website and have an overview of our modules and products. Please also, I invite you to watch over our a very good amount of articles in our developer portal. You see a very good amount of topics going from Yocto to drivers to how to do something with Horizon Core, UART communication, anything. We try to provide the best support as possible. And if you have any issue using Toradex products directly or indirectly, please feel free to reach us out in the community. Also, you can have a glance of what's coming next of our next products in our labs portal. And if you have any issue and want to have a direct one-to-one contact, please feel free to reach us through the support at toradex.com. So thank you again. And I hope you also have a nice day, rest of your week and everything else.
Thank you.
Thank you.
Bye-bye.